I just wanted to start with a couple of thank yous for the honor of being chosen to spend some time with you today. It's really, considering the folks that have come before me, when I took a look at the list, it's quite an honor because of the caliber of people that have stood here before this lecture series. And when I was asked, I looked at that list and I thought, well, I'm really the brown shoes on the black tuxedo here. But there were some giants in the field that have been friends and mentors and colleagues to me. And so I'm really glad to have that chance. And then I also was proud to be asked because my mother, who lives up in Wisconsin, where I grew up, she doesn't always get what I do day to day as a policy analyst and a policy advocate. And, everyone has that trouble. How do you explain what your day job is? But when I tell her that I got invited to give a lecture at a prestigious university, that she understands. And then she goes around to all the neighborhood ladies and says, my son is a guest lecturer. And so thank you not only for the honor of being here, but also for giving my mom those neighborhood bragging rights. I wanted to also thank colleagues from across the state that I've had a chance to work with over the years in my career, and some of them are here and made the trip in, so I really appreciate that. It's good to see you all. And I want to give a special thanks to Ann McMillan and her family. The service that you have given to the state and this community, the example of leadership that you've shown, and your support, your generous support of this program bringing us together is really appreciated, so thank you. Start with a quick overview of what I plan to present today. First of all, so we chose the theme blue skies, stormy weather. It's not necessarily binary. It could be partly cloudy outlook. But I decided that we need some optimism in these days. So not only did we go with the blue skies, but because I'm a father, we'll talk about it. I added in the rainbows and the fairies and the unicorns because my daughters really like that slide. And then, or are we looking at stormy weather? And even there, as a kind of natural optimist, I had to find one that has, at least there's some light on the horizon and some chance to find a way through the storms and common ground. So that's sort of a theme that I'll preview for you today. But what I want to talk about, really kind of organize the talk into three sections. First, starting through repeal and replace of the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare. What does that mean for the future of maternal and child health? I added in some, you've maybe noticed some of the headlines, some discussion in Washington now about changing some of the terminology. Are we really repealing? Are we delaying? Are we renaming? Just in the last few days, they floated this idea of just does it need to be repaired? And I think they're getting some pushback on that, along with saying that it's a moving picture. But we'll talk that through, what that means particularly to maternal and child health populations. Really critical dialogue about what's going to happen with the federal budget, what that means for public health budgets in particular. So we'll go through that. And in the future, some key MCH programs, particularly Medicaid, CHIP, and the relatively new federal maternal and infant early childhood home visiting program that's been a great success. We'll talk about what might be coming from them. I wanted to also just share a quick little background. You heard I work for the Association of Maternal and Child Health Programs, so a quick commercial on who we are. Essentially a national association, membership association. The majority of our members work in state health departments or sometimes universities or other public health agencies. Leading maternal and child health programs and with a component also leading programs for children with special health care needs. That's who we are. I kind of like to point out that we have a vision of a nation that values and invests in the health of women and children, and that's something we'll certainly be talking about today. But before we jump into that, you heard in my bio that I'm an English major. What I had already referenced is that I'm also a father of two girls. They're age 8 and 6. And so you know what that means, right? Dad jokes! And so let's start with the first story of the day I became a father. And this is a true story, or at least starts as a true story, where my wife, we were going through the pregnancy and we found out the baby was breech, and so we were going to have a scheduled C-section. And there was something about that, you have a date and a time when you have to show it, and then we're still nervous, first-time parents, but knew what time we were supposed to report to the hospital. So we go to Sibley Hospital in Washington, D.C., at our appointed time, and walk into the maternity ward. And as we're coming in, they wheel in this woman and her husband, and she's in active labor. And they're looking a little frazzled, and all of a sudden, she just screams out, "Don't, can't, won't, couldn't, shouldn't, wouldn't." And so the father, this a little bit younger than me and very frazzled, he looks at me, he locks eyes with me, and I'm thinking, I'm a policy analyst. There's nothing I can do here. And luckily, their OB walked up, and she said, "It's okay, it's okay. She's just going through some contractions. Don't, can't, won't." English major, MCH, policy. Yeah. Stay tuned, we got a few more, a little shorter. But yeah, so turning to some more serious matters. I wanted to talk, we've got a lot to go through today, and I think I wanted to start with just an acknowledgement that the question, what does the election results mean for MCH policy? The simple answer is that things are going to change. Thank you, and we'll talk to you next year. The more nuanced answer is, you know, nobody really knows for sure what's going to happen. This is a great period of uncertainty and disquiet. And I'm reminded of the great Yogi Berra line that predictions are hard, especially when they're about the future. And so I didn't want to just kind of leave it as things are uncertain, but rather kind of walk through what are some of the scenarios that we can begin to plan for as professionals, as leaders in the field, and know what's coming. But I think the big picture is obviously that this was a hard-fought campaign season and emotions are still very raw. I think it's fair to say, you know, a good chunk of the country is very excited and energized about the direction we're going and what's going to happen next. And there's another good chunk of the country that is feeling very fearful and apprehensive. And I think it's just important to acknowledge that we're living in very divided, divisive times, and that that adds to the fear and uncertainty. And I think, you know, to acknowledge that people are fearful and anxious. So that's the context. So, but let's, before we get into some specifics, I also wanted to acknowledge that one of the great things when I read about the purpose of this lecture series was that it has a component of highlighting breakthroughs in the field. And so on this one, in one slide, I wanted to kind of capture what a lot of the previous lectures before had covered in great depth. And if you haven't seen those, either here in person, since they're online, I would recommend, you know, to take a look. And really the three breakthroughs that we've had in the field of maternal and child health over the last decade or so in my career that I think really offer the best path forward for us are threefold. One is the life course theory. And for those of you, I'm just kind of curious, are people familiar with this? Some yes, some no. I mean, essentially what life course theory is a way of looking at systems that don't look at specific periods of time, but look at the cumulative effect of both positive and negative impact on people's health. It connects intergenerational. So we get to that two-gen approach. And it really gets us thinking outside of the medical model into what happens across the life course of an individual, how a daughter and is connected to the health of her mother and then the grandmother to that baby, to her granddaughter. So it really gets us thinking kind of outside of that box. The preconception care movement, again, I think this really grew in the last maybe decade or two, where there was a recognition that our infant mortality rates have been coming down steadily and then we're flattening out. And in the sense of we had expanded Medicaid throughout the 80s, we had made huge strides forward in ensuring access to early prenatal care, quality prenatal care, and in a sense that we still weren't getting the outcomes we wanted to see. And so what was the next level to take that to? Understanding that prenatal care within an MCH world is essential and fundamental, but what else is necessary to get outcomes? And so the preconception care movement really got us to think about how do we focus on the health of women and girls before and between pregnancies, and also bring in their partners and focus on male reproductive health as well. And I think that really has the potential to move us outside of that kind of narrow focus. I think the way we've framed it is 7 or 8 months of the world's best prenatal care can't reverse the lifetime of unhealthy behaviors and exposures that come before that. So broadening our view again, looking at the health of women, how we improve that. There's a clinical component to that with clinical preventive services. There's also that community health. Are we making sure our communities are as healthy as they can be for healthy moms, healthy families, healthy babies? But it really, I think, had been a breakthrough in thinking. And then the third one has really been this explosion of understanding of brain science. And many people on the forefront of this, the Institute of Medicine back in the 90s, their Neurons to Neighborhoods, that might have been the 2000s, but their seminal report on Neurons to Neighborhoods, the work of Jack Shonkoff and others up at Harvard on the impact of the developing brain of a child, the importance of those first 1,000 days, 3 to 5 years, where we really have a better understanding of how those brains are forming and building that architecture upon which, the scaffolding on which future development rests, and the importance of getting that right and really finding the protective factors. So that, and connected with, another breakthrough in understanding of adverse childhood experiences, and this was based a study out of Kaiser in the 1990s, late 1990s, that looked at how many children are exposed to things like violence, whether and abuse, and things in the home, whether it's divorce or substance abuse or mental illness, and how that affects their health much later on in life. It tracked children through, and found that a lot of diseases, chronic diseases, showing up later in life could be linked. Kids that had 3 or more ACEs in childhood were at much higher risk later in life. And what it found, I think, was about a third of kids that weren't reporting any, but together, I think it's about 40% that were reporting 3 or more. So just knowing the challenge that we have, but then the opportunity to use that new science to move forward. And I think collectively, this is really important that these three things will help us get to that root causes of disparities. And that's something we've dealt with for decades in public health, but we know are persistent. And when I was preparing for this, you know, looking at some of the situation in Alabama, and I think you all are familiar with this, I had a boss that always told me, you know, always start with a positive. And so one of the things that I think you all should be really proud of, you're, I think, about fifth in the nation in childhood in coverage for children. And so fifth, let me see, what's the best way to say it? Fifth highest of children covered. And that's just amazing that you've been able to do that and sustain that. And I think is just a wonderful leadership that you've shown, the commitment to that. But as you know, when it comes to obesity and then certainly infant mortality, there's so much opportunity for improvement. Nice way to frame that. And particularly with infant mortality, that in maternal child health, we talk about that being our sentinel measure. When we see here in Alabama that those gaps had widened a little bit recently, and normally, nationally, we've always said that the rates for African Americans are in some places double, in some places triple, and it looks like that's where the numbers in Alabama were leading, that the black-white gap in infant mortality being about three times. Certainly, that's something that needs more attention, and I know y'all are focused and working on that, committed to it. My job, I see, is, you know, is helping get some of the resources, not only for you all, but for all states to address those issues, and really taking these breakthroughs and putting them into practice. So that's kind of a quick overview. There's three big challenges that I think just to put on the table as we think this through. And that's the first one of what we do in public health is always whine to policymakers. You don't get us, you don't understand us, you don't fund us. We're only 3% of the federal spending, or, you know, of the total healthcare budget. And I've been trying to tell myself and my colleagues that we have to stop whining and take ownership of that, that that's our responsibility to begin doing a better job of explaining to policymakers the difference between publicly financed healthcare, that's Medicare, that's Medicaid, CHIP, community health centers, and what public health does that's outside of a medical context, outside of the clinic's office, whether it's assuring clean air, clean water, working on perinatal regionalization, working on SIDS messages to new parents. There's so many examples we can use of how these two things need to complement each other. But clearly the consequence of that is that we don't get adequate investments in prevention. And so particularly with large deficits, that's the kind of talk in Washington right now is what can we afford when we're borrowing money essentially to pay for these programs? How do we decide and prioritize? And so we'll talk that through a little bit. And then the kind of most discouraging part is seen in my 22 years or so in Washington, the disintegration of a center in American politics where there's very few moderates in either party now that are willing to come together, let people fight, but then at the end of the day come together and say, where's our common ground to get a deal here? And I think that's been what's been alarming, and seeing how this is playing out where politicians on both sides of the aisles aren't rewarded for compromise. And in fact, with all the money pouring in and the way they raise money, it really pushes those divisions further. You only get rewarded for being on the extremes now. That's how people get fundraising bonanzas, when they are obstructing or fighting, and rather than finding common ground and compromising. So don't know that I have solutions to that, but we can talk that through a little bit, just kind of the impact. But again, the context we're in. So the whole kind of focus on today's talk is what is about to happen in Washington, and how will that either help or hinder some of these things that the breakthroughs we've been talking about in the specific programs. So I wanted to start with greetings from ONC. You're probably wondering, what is that? That's code, that's not the swamp. Instead, that's our nation's capital. And I do that because everybody loves acronyms and alphabet soup and abbreviations in DC. But here's kind of the way people are describing what's happening in Washington right now. And I think you're certainly hearing this and seeing this in headlines. We've never seen so many rules of politics kind of be suspended now, and how people are treating each other, the division in the way the Senate is working, which it normally prides itself on being the more genteel body of going along, getting along, that so much division and rancor is just kind of the rigor for the day. But let's jump in the future of the affordable healthcare. So with all that environment, how do we find a path forward on that key challenge about providing health insurance coverage to all Americans? And so here's a word cloud. You know, all these things have been part of the debate. Why is this so challenging? And I think I have a little problem with it. This is the Milman Medical Index. I wanted to call your attention, if you look to the last presidential term, President Obama elected in 2008, this is the average premiums for a family of four. Elected in 2008, Affordable Care Act passes in 2010, it had already gone up around $3,000 to $18,000. And then we see in most of the ACA coverage provisions not kicking in until 2014, but kind of this unrelenting increase in the cost of health insurance for a family of four. And then comparing that, I know this is a busy slide and maybe not instantly understandable, but when you look at the medium household income of America and you see it's around the 50 some thousand, and you compare that to 25,000 for a family, you can instantly see the challenge of how can healthcare be affordable when at least half of the median, at least half of the income households in this family, households in this country, would essentially, without any help, have to use half of their income and a growing part of that would eat into their wages. So that's the challenge. And then the poverty rate, you see, you know, where that's come, and knowing that the Medicaid program will usually pick up those at the very most extreme of poverty. The Affordable Care Act trying to expand that and picking up more of those folks, and I know how that's, you know, you've had debates and discussion about that here. But I think those two together, the cost of health insurance for a family and the median wage, that's the kind of extreme gravity that any policymaker is trying to come together. How do we find a way to make this affordable in that environment? I think the Affordable Care Act sure has been through the ringer and litigated in the elections, and I think you could say it's fair, you know, people wanted to see change, they voted for change, and certainly the current president has repeatedly describes it as a disaster, and I think everyone acknowledges it's not a perfect law, and there is real concerns about affordability, but one of the things that it did do, and you can see the you know, precipitous drop there, and this, you know, it doesn't look like that big of a line, but when you think that represents from 2013 to 2015, 20 million Americans, is what that line represents, and for the first time having their insurance rate or uninsured rate fall between 10%, certainly something that presidents from Teddy Roosevelt on had tried to tackle and achieve without success until the Affordable Care Act, and I think that's now what's at stake, is how do we make sure that we at least maintain that line, if not build upon it. Last thought on kind of that challenge, Uwe Reinhardt, I don't know how many of you have a favorite health economist, but he's mine. He's up at Princeton, James Madison, Princeton of Political Economy, I think is what he is. And he just put it, you know, I think as bluntly as you can, is that dilemma is, are we going to, for those who can't afford it, do you increase tax revenues to broaden coverage, or will you continue as far as the eye can see? And I think everybody knows that, you know, for the majority of politicians, the idea of talking about tax increases is just a non-starter. So how do you do this under an environment where there's budget caps and there's not likely to be agreement on any of those revenue adjustments? I think, you know, the perspective that we in public health bring to this is, as important as the debate over health insurance is, and it certainly is, we know, and they're taught in public health schools, that health insurance alone is necessary but insufficient to get that kind of health outcomes we want. And so I'm kind of surprised that this hasn't been a bigger part of the story. And more politicized, but it was just in December, we saw in some of the CDC data that we actually slipped for the first time in decades on our gains in life expectancy. And one of the things we can say in public health is, for the most part, we've had, you know, over a century, really pretty steady progress on life expectancy, on infant mortality, on some of the central measures. And so to see this happen, and to see it happen at a time when millions more people were gaining coverage and when we were spending literally hundreds of billions of dollars more on insuring folks, to see that slip in life expectancy, it's only 0.1%, and certainly, are there any epidemiologists in the room or biostatisticians? And you all certainly will say, you know, that this could be an anomaly, it's the 1 year effect, we need to see if this is a trend or not. So with all those caveats, I think, you know, we want to be aware of that, but to see this happen at a time when kind of the holy grail of health reform, expanding coverage, I think it really gives us an opportunity and puts us at a crossroads to really think through, well, how do we do this better? If we're revisiting the debate on health reform, how do we do that in a way that accelerates outcomes? And I think it's probably hard to read, but one of the things that they attributed this increase to, certainly the overdose deaths, and they call them the diseases of despair. Obesity, alcoholism, and overdose are some of what's driving those numbers. And I think it's very clear that if we don't get our arms around the obesity epidemic, the future wave of chronic disease that's so predictable. So it's something that, you know, when politicians debate health reform, it's all about kind of takes all the air in the room on health insurance coverage, health insurance reform. And I think, again, we have an opportunity at this crossroads to really, as public health leaders, insert this public health science to say, let's look at the data and have a good discussion about how we accelerate progress, what we can include in a potential replacement plan that will get us further along. And I don't have to tell you all this, you know, the dilemma here is we spend, I think, on average twice as much as the average industrialized country with much worse outcomes. And you certainly know where we stand in infant mortality. And I think what was fascinating to me was this understanding that we're always near 30th, 26th, 30th, but it wasn't always that way. Back in the early 60s, we were 11th, and we've had this steady decline. We've been losing ground. And so at the risk of getting into kind of political slogans, but the question is, how do we make our public health system great again? How do we get from 26 up to at least the top 10? I think there's an opportunity to use some of that messaging that will resonate with the folks that are in charge now. The other piece that we use when trying to make this case, and a lot of public health, you'll hear me say, is focused on connecting our science to our messaging. One of the things that we do really well, and again, that Alabama's been a leader in, is we spend a lot of money on insuring kids. And as you know, as a father of an 8-year-old and a 6-year-old, we're probably up at the pediatricians every 6 to 8 weeks, their pink eye for, sore throat. So I'm the first to say, we want people to have health insurance. That's critical and fundamental, and it keeps people out of bankruptcy. And as a parent, I wouldn't want to go without. And yet, when we look at this number, it's 7.1% was the overall number a few years ago, the number of uninsured kids. And yet 33%, about a third, are either overweight or obese in America. I think there's very few better illustrations of where health insurance alone isn't solving this problem. It certainly can contribute, and there's a lot that pediatricians can do in the office, but if that's not backed up by policies and programs in the community that where the kids live, that the other 300 and some days in the year that they're not in the doctor's office, we're not gonna get the progress we need. So this is the kind of messaging we use with policymakers to say we're spending tens of billions of dollars a year to insure kids. The entire budget of CDC's Chronic Disease Center, which not only focuses on obesity but several other chronic diseases, is only a little bit over $1 billion. Our investments are a little bit, here's the slide on that, that shows our investments are not balanced in a way that will let us get progress. So that's kind of where we're looking at the big challenges in the future of Affordable Care Act. Here's the current state of play, and this is what's fun about living in Washington is kind of like the weather. If you don't like what's going on, wait a day or two and it will change. And certainly following the state of play on what's been promised and what will be delivered on repeal of the Affordable Care Act, I guess this maybe shouldn't be surprising, that it's easy to campaign on slogans, it's harder to govern. And so one of the things that's happened is a real slowdown in that kind of 6-year push of give us power, give us a president that will sign a repeal and we will get that done on day one. It turns out the details are a little messier than that. And so the headline on the left, that it's stalling on the details. And then on the right, I wanted to include this just because it shows how some of just the big picture terminology on are we trying to repair the Affordable Care Act? Can you repair it by replacing it? I don't want to say turning themselves into pretzels, but there's a lot of angst, I think, within the Republican Party right now of how they first come to agreement on what they want to do for replacement. And the critical questions on timing and whether people will lose coverage or whether insurance markets are going to destabilize while that's being figured out. So this is the worst slide that I have, in the sense that I tell this story. My old boss came into my office one day and he tossed a book at me, and I looked at it, and the book was called Why Most PowerPoint Presentations Suck. And this is exactly why, that they're too wordy and that people lean on them too much. They read to you from the slides. But the background on this is I wanted to share it because these are the president's own words. And so I didn't want anyone to think that I was either twisting what he was saying or editorializing him. But what it shows is an evolution of thinking. And so just to go through these really quickly, November 1st, a week before the election, a campaign rally, the vow was to immediately repeal and replace Obamacare, even asking Congress to do a special session so they could repeal and replace. So urgency, right? We're going to do this and right away. January 11th, he's won the election. So then, in a Washington Post interview, there would be a repeal and replace plan for Obamacare. And as soon as the Senate approves his nominee for HHS, it's Tom Price from Georgia, it would essentially be simultaneously the day or the same day or same week, could be the same hour. And what's interesting on that is I think with your Senator Sessions getting approved yesterday, I think the next nominee up for Senate approval is supposed to be Tom Price. So that could be either happening today or tomorrow. But I don't think you want to hold your breath that it's going to come at the same hour as he's installed, because then a week later, or 3 days later, and here's where it really gets fascinating. We're going to have insurance for everybody, the president-elect said. There was a philosophy in some circles that if you can't pay for it, you don't get it. That's not going to happen with us. People covered under the law can expect great health care. It'll be in a much simplified form, much less expensive, much better, lower numbers, much lower deductibles. Note that, much lower deductibles. It's being formulated down to the final strokes. We haven't put it in quite yet, but we're going to be doing it soon. January 14th, the president does a television interview and is asked that question, can you expect a plan to be rolled out this year? And the response was, in the process, maybe take some time until next year, but we're certainly going to be in the process. Very complicated. Obamacare is a disaster. You have to remember, Obamacare doesn't work, so we are putting together a wonderful plan. It statutorily takes a little while to get. We're going to be putting it in fairly soon. I think that, yes, I would like to say by the end of the year, at least the rudiments, but should have something within the year and the following year. So I don't do this to, you know, embarrass the president in any way, but I think there's a positive way to look at it. There's an evolution in thinking and a realization that they understand that it's complicated. That's true. If it were easy, it would have been done. When the Affordable Care Act was put in place, that was about 18 months of development and hearings and markups and a lot of legislative maneuvering. So I think, you know, there was a sense of the election was won, and in large part on that message about Obamacare doesn't work, needs to be repealed and replaced immediately. And I think the reality is now setting in, the difference between campaigning and governing. I think there's a cynical way to look that the people that have said, we want to replace it have had 7 years to come up with a plan. But I think that it's fair to say they didn't think they were going to have a president that would actually sign it, so they're finding themselves a little bit behind. And at the same time, when you've run on that message of we will replace it, it seems that you would have more agreement, at least on a plan, what that would look like. And so this is a long way of saying it's going to take some time and nobody's really sure what's going to happen next. That was, a few days ago. Stay tuned, because I think this is going to change a lot of zig and zag on expected times. But that's the evolution on that. What did happen, and for those that were looking for immediate action, on January 20th, the president issued this executive order. Again, a good example of why PowerPoint's not good, but for those who were curious, what does an executive order actually look like? This is it. And essentially, this is an order on Obamacare that does two things. One is it states very clearly the policy of the administration is to repeal and replace. And then importantly, what it does is give officials, not only at HHS, but also at Treasury and IRS and Labor and other places, all the authority within the law to waive or delay or not enforce provisions of the Affordable Care Act. So clearly a sign that when those folks come in, and the issue is people said, well, how are we supposed to interpret this? What does this mean? What's going to happen? Nobody knows for sure, and it's partly because most of the Trump appointees aren't in place yet. And so I think it's sort of a wait and see. But it's a shot across the bow that if they wanted to stop enforcing the individual mandate, for instance, or assessing penalties for not buying insurance, those things are on the table and they're allowed. I think the pushback on that is that could have a very destabilizing effect on the insurance market, and plans would start to leave, and what would happen then. So, but that for those that were looking for immediate action, that was evidence of the administration's commitment. So hopefully this is my last worst slide. That question, okay, so if we're moving towards replacement, even if we don't know about the timing, what will it include? And I think here there's a sense that you can expect there's certain conservative principles that the Republicans have put in many of their different bills, competing bills, none that have gotten to the sense of that they have everybody's backing. But certain things, there's a sense that they want to retain the coverage for kids up to 26 on their parents' plan and retain the pre-existing condition exclusion, because they know those are popular. Rather than have a mandate that insurers have to sell, they're looking at finding a way that it becomes more on the responsibility of the consumer to keep continuous coverage. As long as you have continuous coverage, then you can't be excluded for pre-existing conditions. And I think there's room for debate on whether that's realistic, particularly for families that are struggling, that may be losing jobs, how you maintain that continuous coverage, especially if you're dealing with a baby that was born prematurely or with severe special needs. How do you make sure you're not penalized just by having that misfortune? Refundable tax credits. Again, this is part of the Affordable Care Act, that they're subsidies for buying insurance. I think one of the concerns that have been stated with some of the Republican proposals is they use a standard tax deduction for everybody, whether you're rich or poor. It's not indexed to your income level, and therefore those that need it the most, it might not be enough help. And I think it's kind of been described of, I think the leading proposal is about, I think it's about $2,000 tax credit. But again, if your family insurance is costing $25,000, a family of four, you get $8,000 in tax credit. You've got a rope that goes only about a third of the way down, so 8 feet down a 24-foot hole, an 8-foot rope to help you get out of a 24-foot deep hole. Is that right? I'm trying to make the metaphor of the rope being too short to pull you out of the hole. So that's a big concern, I think, of what's happening. And we won't go through all these, but they include the high risk pools, which a number of states have experimented with mixed results. And I think there's some angst that it might work, but is it a good idea to segregate people out into a high risk pool if we don't know that we're going to have enough money to cover that? Insurance across state lines, that's certainly been talked. But here's a kind of a curious one to watch there's always been this encouragement of health savings accounts. And you saw the president talk about people complaining about the deductibles being too high with Obamacare, that it makes insurance, you know, it makes it essentially too expensive to use your insurance. Well, the HSA approach essentially is a catastrophic plan with a high deductible plan. So the solution that they're proposing, or a part of the solution, kind of conflicts with a promise to bring those deductibles down. And so I think there's probably room for debate on how big of a role that will play. But I think if that's the solution is HSAs to the problem of high deductibles, there's something fundamentally competing there. And then removing the individual mandate. And you know, we're Americans. Nobody likes to be told what to do. Nobody likes mandates. But the whole idea behind the mandate was you needed a big enough risk pool to keep it afloat. And you had to have young and healthy people paying into the system to support those that are older and sicker. And what seems curious to a lot of folks analyzing this is this idea of you could take away the mandate. It's akin to essentially saying, we will sell you flood insurance the day after the flood. You can't let people out of the system and then in only when they need it, because that will not give you the risk pool you need. So I think how they handle that, the politics of the mandate, my sense is that's one where we might see some sort of renaming. You call it the freedom option or something that requires you to buy, and maybe the penalty is so big that it's not necessarily a mandate, but it's a mandate in practice. So that'll be one to watch. There's the other piece here on what you might include on Medicaid, I think we'll hold and cover later on. Let's do a quick time check. We need to speed this up a little bit. So five key questions from an MCH lens. I think front and center, seeing how far the 20 million folks or so that gained coverage under Obamacare, about half of that was through the Medicaid expansion, half through the exchanges. We know not every state chose to expand Medicaid. I think it's about 32. Of those 32, there's a dozen states with Republican governors that have exercised that option. So the key question then becomes, does a repeal effort eliminate the Medicaid expansion? If you look at some of the previous Republican repeal bills that have passed, and then including the one that was vetoed by the president last fall, they all repealed that Medicaid expansion. What has happened since then is a number of governors from both sides of the aisle have said, hold on, if we repeal that, we're instantly essentially kicking 10 million of those 20 million off of coverage. We've kind of committed to this idea that we don't want to pull the rug out from underneath people. So I think the politics of the Medicaid expansion are certainly in play. And I think how that would play out for Alabama is important. Of if it's taken off the table, would eliminate the ability for you to revisit that debate down the line if you see how other states are either succeeding or not succeeding with their expansion. That's going to be a key question. What happens to the Medicaid expansion? Secondly is the quality of coverage. And here, too, the Republican mantra has been, we don't like the mandates on insurance coverage. Those drive up the cost for everybody. From an MCH perspective, there are several key essential benefits in that list of 10. I pulled out, I think, four or five here that are really key and important to MCH populations. Certainly maternity and newborn care, mental health services and addiction treatment, rehab services and devices, particularly important for kids with special needs, preventive care and pediatric services. So if those mandates go away, the kind of step forward that we take, and particularly with mental health and addiction treatment, there was the parity law that said if insurers cover it, they have to cover it equal. What the Affordable Care Act does is take that revolution in our understanding and destigmatization of these issues and really take it a step further by saying not only does it have to be equally covered, but it has to be covered. And I think that's been a step forward for the people that in our country that are dealing with those issues. So huge questions there. What happens with those insurance mandates? The maternity one has been interesting to see the politics. There's been a number of legislators who have kind of stepped into a little bit of a battle by saying, I don't need maternity care. I'm a 60-year-old man. I don't need maternity coverage for my plan. And the retort from that, from some of the women on the other side of the aisle, has been, no, you might not, but your mother sure did, and your daughter might. And so it's this idea of, are we in this together, or are we going to segregate out certain services because I don't need them myself? And I think that the example is, you know, would somebody say, well, we shouldn't cover prostate care, that should not be included in insurance plans because prostate cancer, because, you know, certain women wouldn't need that. And it's this idea of, the concept of insurance is pooling risk together, not segregating it out. And so I think that'll be the fundamental part of that debate. The mandate to cover clinical preventive services, including birth control, and I know that's not without controversy, but with no cost sharing. And there, I think the step forward with the Affordable Care Act has been to say, let's not put up barriers to preventive care. We already know the challenges for docs that they have on both time and reimbursement to get that done. Let's try to at least lower some of those barriers and increase utilization, and do that by making sure that people aren't charged out of pocket. So that'll be a big question. I think the early signs are that those mandates are not likely to stay, but something that'll be debated. The annual lifetime out-of-pocket caps, certainly for a family born with a premature baby, they can meet those former annual caps within a year or two. That's been a way to say that, you know, in America's, in the richest country in the world, people shouldn't go bankrupt just because they've had the misfortune of having somebody be sick. And so looking at those caps will be important. And then finally, the prevention fund, and this has been covered increasingly in the last few weeks. The Affordable Care Act set aside money in a mandatory fund to fund public health activities. And 60 times the Republicans have voted to repeal that because they didn't like the way it was set up. They thought there was some lack of accountability. And so it's pretty endangered. But the reality is most of that money today funds about 10% of CDC's budget for things like existing programs around immunizations, chronic disease, epi and lab capacity, the Preventive Services Block Grant. And so we've been trying to raise a real flag of caution that if you repeal that part of the Affordable Care Act, essentially the appropriators who are dealing with a cap have to find $1 billion in that budget so CDC doesn't instantly take $1 billion cut. And so that's been a real place that folks have been focused. And here's a good example where in the past these things were not partisan issues. CDC, the programs, vaccines have not been partisan issues. The mechanism to fund them and including that in the Affordable Care Act has raised the temperature, and it's certainly part of the debate going forward how we get that money to stay in the system. Switching, let's turn to budget outlines, but why don't, going over a lot of serious stuff, probably time for a quick dad joke break. I saw one, I don't know, did you, biostatistician or epidemiologist? Any biostatisticians in the room? There we go. So here's one for you. What does a baby computer call his father? Data. Data. Yep. The budget. Okay, so again, the way this played out in the election, you know, we know that we're essentially, you know, we're spending more than we're taking in every year. And people sometimes get a little confused, the difference between the debt and the deficit. The deficit is the annual difference in that, the debt is the cumulative. And that's where the big number, when people say the debt under the previous president has gone up this many trillions of dollars. And that's because every year right now we're spending $591 billion more every year than we take in. Somebody once said, what's $1 trillion look like? I don't know, but we got this graphic that it would go around the world 67,000 miles. To get $1 trillion in $1 bills. So maybe we should do that in 10 and cut it down a little bit. But where are we? So here again, a lot of speculation, a lot of angst. There was a report that came out just a few days before the inauguration that Trump's team was working with the part of the White House that's called the Office of Management and Budget that puts together the first federal proposal for a budget every year. And you all know from Schoolhouse Rocks, the president proposes, sends it to the Hill, then they dispose. But that's really the start of the process. And it was pretty eye-popping what they reported, that there was in the works a plan that would cut $10 trillion over 10 years. And they had listed that there were a couple of blueprints they were working from, some that were from some conservative think tanks, some that were from some of the Republican budgets that had been proposed on the Hill previously that hadn't gone anywhere. But I think it got everyone's attention that this is serious and that they're really planning to propose some deep cuts. And they were planning some program eliminations. There was very few outside of the Affordable Care Act, very few that were health programs that were included in the blueprints they referenced. One they did reference was phasing out the Head Start program over 10 years and saving, I forget how much that would save. But they raised some concerns that the data showing the lasting effects of Head Start wasn't strong enough. I think there's a number of studies that have refuted that specific one that they did. But that's the kind of level that we're at right now, is they're starting to look, are there programs that could be proposed for elimination? Are there some either across the board cuts or deep cuts in public health and other agencies that can be proposed? People ask, well, where should we look for this? They said they want to do what's known as a skinny budget in 45 days, just a kind of first top line. That won't give us the details that we need to know of how the impact on specific MCH programs would be. But then around 100 days, so late April is the target that they said to release a full first federal budget proposal. Then that goes up to Capitol Hill and kind of taken from there. So then people ask, well, why are we in such deep trouble, and what's the drivers of those deficits? I mean, I think people know this intuitively, that it's the main drivers of the federal debt are the things that are entitlement spending: Medicare, Medicaid, CHIP, Social Security. You could see that's the red line that in the blue line underneath there. That's the long-term drivers of the debt. And those things go to people who are eligible. So Congress doesn't each year decide how much money for those programs. There's some, you know, in some sense on autopilot. If you're eligible, you will get those services. And so those are already baked into the budget. The important piece here is the discretionary piece that you can see has taken quite a hit and declined starting at the recession in the late 2008, 2009. And there's two parts of that discretionary part of the budget. There's defense and non-defense. And it's kind of an odd term to say discretionary part of the budget, because I don't think, you know, you think of your discretionary money as the money for a movie on Friday night with your family if you have it. This is some key things that are in that part of the budget, such as defense, national parks, law enforcement, the FBI. They're considered part of the discretionary part of the budget because every year Congress looks and decides what level of funding should we put there. And the unfortunate part is because of the growth in entitlements, most of the pressure, most of the cuts that Congress has made, as you can see, have really been on that non-defense discretionary part. So that's where all of the key, outside of Medicaid and CHIP and technically the home visiting program, that's where a lot of public health agencies get their funding. Most of HRSA and CDC is in that line of discretionary, non-defense discretionary. Here's some examples: the Title V MCH block grant that my organization has as top priority, Healthy Start, WIC, newborn screening. I could have done a much longer list, but just to give you a sense, these are the programs that we think are most vulnerable in that push of, if we're going to cut $1 trillion from the budget, what would that look like? So people ask, you know, well, what would be the impact of deep cuts in those? And here, this is just to use the Title V program as an example. This is something that my organization, as I mentioned, is our top priority. It's the common thread of our membership. And we've really been pushed in recent years to increase our accountability and show how we're using evidence-based strategies to drive outcomes. And so on this, we have 15 national performance now measures that every state chooses every year. They look, every 5-year cycle, they'll look at these 15 national performance measures and choose a number that they're going to focus on. It just so happens the ones I highlighted in red are the ones that Alabama's chosen. So the point of these slides is to show you these are the types of services and activities that would be vulnerable to a cut if that pressure to cut the discretionary part of the budget comes through. These are important issues. They're sometimes, you know, sometimes have a clinical component, sometimes more of a public health community component. But we are using this as an example of what would be at stake if we see deep proposed cuts in these programs. And every other program, I think, it will be able to show that. It's hard to know for sure how this will play out. I think there's a real appetite on the Hill to do budget cuts, to be serious about that. But I think there's also the complication that once you start getting to specific programs, you see people come out of the woodwork that say, well, we certainly have to cut, just not that program. And so one of the great examples in that budget blueprint that was referenced was a federal program that helps subsidize rural airports. And instantly after that came out, the two senators from Alaska said, well, you know what? We can't eliminate that program because, you know, there's parts of Alaska you can't even get to without highways. That's what our lifeblood for Alaska. And so they're Republican senators. So, okay, well, then you have to take that off the table. And I just raise that as an example that all these programs will have champions. And so just because they're proposed for cuts immediately doesn't mean they'll actually happen. But that's where the battle will be coming is how does Congress look at those? Who are they listening to on what to preserve, what can be trimmed, what could be eliminated? And so we'll finish up with that in a second. The other key part on the federal budget is something to watch with the order on sanctuary cities. And I know this has been covered and is contentious, but this idea that any city that doesn't have their law enforcement cooperating with immigration and customs on deportation and essentially immigration enforcement is now under threat of losing their federal funding. And this is something that is just fascinating and I think alarming to a lot of people, the chilling effect that it might have. And the whole state of California is in the process of considering, should we consider ourselves a sanctuary state? And so there's now reports going around in Washington that the state of California is about to go to war with President Trump. And an irony here that President Trump has a worse relationship with California than he does with Russia. But the fact of the matter is the threat is out there that that they will pull federal funding from any city or state that's not complying. And if you think of that in public health terms, and there's an exception for law enforcement grants, so those would go. But when you think of this in public health terms, would you stop San Francisco's any other federal funding to track infectious diseases to see if SARS and Ebola and other things that real infectious communicable disease issues? Would you want to lock up the public health infrastructure of any city to be able to protect the entire public from infectious disease to make this point? And it's a threat that's out there. I think it's something to watch. I don't know how it's going to play out. It's kind of hard to think, when you think of California's economy being bigger than most countries, the impact that would have on jobs and on people in California. But the threat is out there, and I think they're collecting information now at the budget office to say, here's the grants that you would lose if you persist in not cooperating. So something to watch. What's in store for key MCH programs? Medicaid, CHIP, and McV. The future of Medicaid. So here's where the Republican ideology has been since 1981. We should block grant Medicaid, cap the funding, give it to states. The state of play, there's proposals on the table now to block grant Medicaid. And one of the slides I had was a letter from the National Governors Association, which normally doesn't weigh in on anything in health policy because governors don't agree on anything anymore. But surprisingly, they agreed to put together a letter to congressional leaders that says, we're concerned of, and they didn't say block grant, they didn't say per capita cap, but they said, we're concerned with proposals that would shift costs to states. And we're also concerned with proposals that would limit the ability of our states to respond in times of epidemic or spike in prices. And so they, I think in one letter, raised concerns about both a block grant and a per capita cap approach to Medicaid, which is surprising because usually the governors are pretty silent on that and neutral. The Democratic governors will say one thing, Republican governors will say another. But I think that was a shot across the bow that it's not necessarily a slam dunk to make major changes to those programs. So that's the concise, where the future's there. But something to watch, and there's a question of would a health reform replacement bill include a block grant? Would it be done through a separate legislative vehicle? People really don't know right now. But the CHIP program, and again, really been critical to the success here in Alabama, that is on a separate time frame for reauthorization. September 30th, the money for that program will run out unless Congress acts. The good news there is there's always been pretty bipartisan support to continue that. And so as of right now, that looks on track to be reauthorized by Congress sometime this summer. The wrinkle is, would they attach some Medicaid reforms to that must pass CHIP bill that could complicate the politics? And I think that's a calculation that we'll see play out. Again, sometime this summer, September 30th is the deadline to watch for that. Finally, the Maternal, Infant, and Early Childhood Home Visiting Program, created as part of the Affordable Care Act, but really building on decades of science about the importance of helping young families, both prenatally or starting early on, that parents need help because kids don't come with an instruction manual if you're living in poverty and other challenges. That idea of having scheduled home visits with either a nurse or a social worker or a trained parent, the success, documented success of that program has really generated bipartisan support. And here's the good news on that program, that even though it was created as part of the Affordable Care Act, there's so much support for it, and it's been pulled out on a different schedule. So that, again, is funded through September 30th of this year. There's a lot of good signs that Speaker Paul Ryan and other Republicans in the House have put that program in press releases and others, praising the success and that it has both on anti-poverty but also improving health and outcomes. So we feel like we're in pretty good shape for that to be continued and in a bright spot with some bipartisan support, but again, it's September 30th is the deadline, so this summer is a time to watch. And I'm right at the noon hour, but one of the questions that I got in kind of preparing for this is, okay, so that's the state of play on these three kind of areas of MCH policy. What can I do? Especially if I'm feeling concerned, or I should, to be fair, if you like the direction that things are going, I think your policymakers want to hear from you on that. If you're concerned, I think they are at a heightened level of attention now because the number of protests that are happening, the kind of revolution in social media for things to go viral instantly and get a buzz and get on their radar, the number of call-in campaigns, whether it's been around some of the appointees or other things. There, if you want to look at this in a positive way, I think democracy has been awakened by what's happening, and that ability of citizens to be in contact and to try to influence their policymakers is a window of opportunity that is open now. So I just wanted to go through, just real quick, do we have just a few more minutes to go through this? Is kind of some of what I've learned in my career, what some of the best practices of some of my fellows have been, of how to approach this idea of advocacy. And I think the guidance that I have for you is that you have to be willing to get involved in that intersection between policy and politics. And I know that scares a lot of people because politics is ugly and it hasn't been very fun. But I think too often in public health school, we're taught epidemiology is the fundamental science of public health and the data will speak for itself and policymakers will look at that data and do the right thing and act. And I think we have example of example where the clearest data leads to either confusion or inaction. And so I think it's really important that as public health leaders, as students, that we think through how do we engage in that intersection where politics and policy come together and how do we try to influence that. And a couple of things that I would just suggest that are kind of some of the basics about advocacy. One thing is this reminder from Grace Abbott. She was the first director of the Children's Bureau in, I think, the 1912, 1920s, I can't even remember exactly, early 20th century. And she used this metaphor about the baby carriage and traffic. And she said, sometimes when I go home at night in Washington, D.C., I look out and I see a traffic jam. And that traffic jam includes the limousines of business and the Department of Commerce going to Capitol Hill. And it includes the plows and the tractors and the implements of agriculture, the Department of Agriculture going to Capitol Hill. And it includes certainly the tanks and the trucks of the Army and the Department of Defense on their way up to Capitol Hill, all trying to make their case of what they need. And she said, but because there's nobody there, I put my hands on the baby carriage and I gently wheel it into traffic because I must join that fight. And I think it gets to this kind of fundamental concept of competencies in public health, that to learn to smartly engage in policy is part of our responsibility, and to make sure that our policymakers know what our views are. And I would just be the first to say, I know that's difficult depending on where you work, and some public health agencies across the country have restrictions on what folks can do. And certainly I would be the first to encourage you to be very cognizant of what your rules around advocacy are, and never misrepresent yourself as an individual as representing an organization that you're not allowed to represent. But as individuals, you retain that constitutional right to petition your government, to make your views known. And I think, like I said, what's exciting about right now is members of Congress are listening and they're trying to figure out the direction that the nation wants to go. So a few things I'd recommend is when one of the most fundamental things in advocacy is to be clear on our ask. And too often we see this where Capitol Hill staffers will say, people come in to talk to me all the time about children's health, and they convince me we need to do more, we need to do more on prevention, but they don't give me a roadmap because they're not specific. And so one of the suggestions we have is always, as far as you can, be as specific as you can with your ask. Here's the situation for children's health, here's the room for opportunity, here's proven solutions, and here's the dollar amount for the program or the law, the number of the law that I'm asking you to pass. And if people can be as specific as possible, I think that's always appreciated. And knowing both the timing and the jurisdiction, when budget decisions are usually formulated in the spring, so to go up to your members of Congress in the fall is usually too late. They might not have finished that for the year, but you want to reach them when they're making decisions. And that's my job at my association, and other associations that you might belong to will send alerts of now the window of opportunity to make your voice heard. So that putting together timing and jurisdiction, and again, knowing who's going to be in the room making decisions, and here's where we focus on trying to reach the people that will be in the room when a deal is made. Every member of Congress is important, but particularly when it comes to public health budgets, the appropriators are the ones that are going to be setting those. And you're fortunate in Alabama, you have two key appropriators, Senator Shelby on the Senate Appropriations Committee and former chair of the Labor HHS subcommittee that sets public health budgets. So he's certainly critical. And then Representative Martha Roby, also on the House side, sits on the Labor HHS subcommittee that makes decisions. So just flagging for you, not encouraging anything that's not appropriate in reaching them, but highlighting that they are in the room when decisions are made. So know the issue, the solutions, be clear with your ask, build relationships. That's one of the things we see, that a lot of times an association will have its people in once a year We encourage people to go to the Hill. It's a one-time meeting and then there's no follow-up. And a lot of what effective advocates say is the meeting should be the first step. The thank you and the follow-up is important, but then keeping in touch and sharing, here's what's happening in my state, here's what's happening in our community with your policymakers so they see you as a trusted resource. We think that that building that relationship over time really helps. So when there's a question or an issue that's open to debate, they'll turn to you for advice. And so that's one of the things we really push, is that building those ongoing relationships. So turning to close, I think, you know, one of the things that's been alarming to a lot of people in Washington is this: are we operating in a fact-free environment? And where is that understanding that science and data and facts and evidence should it support policymaking? I think it's fair to say, you know, this has always been a struggle in American politics. It's not anything that's particularly new, but I think in this environment, the key for us is to connect our data to your story, and that's kind of the thing I really wanted to underscore is statistics matter, but saying here's how that matters in my community, in your district, in your state, Senator. Here's a family whose lives has been changed by this. If we can connect our data to the stories, it's got a much more emotional appeal than just saying the data should inspire action. And there's a quick story I tell that gap between policymakers and scientists. There was a man out in a hot air balloon one day and he got lost. But he saw a farmer down in a field, or he saw a farm field, and it was a guy tinkering with some scientific instruments. So he lowered his hot air balloon down, and he yelled down. He said, "Pardon me, sir." So he said, "Do you know where I am?" "Yes, you're in a balloon. You're in a hot air balloon about 30 feet above my field." The guy in the balloon says, "While your answer is technically accurate, it's absolutely useless to me." Then the guy on the ground says, "By chance, are you a politician?" The man in the balloon says, "I am a politician. How'd you know?" And he says, "Because you don't know where you are and you don't know where you're going, but somehow you think it's my fault." So that's an illustration of the gap between science and politics. Quick one more dad joke and then we'll wrap up here. Where's my, I had to write these down. So what do you get when you cross a newborn snake and a basketball? That's a bouncing baby boa. Last spot, my last slide, I had a picture of a cathedral and also a mosque and a temple. And I think one of the most important things that has been a guide in my career is, you know, you work in politics in Washington, D.C., it's, you know, day to day, who's up, who's down. You work on these annual budgets. Sometimes you get more money, sometimes you lose money. And it can be both exhausting and exhilarating, but it's hard. And when we work in public health, I think there's a sense of, you know, people don't understand or support us as much as they should. And there's a former CDC director by the name of Dr. Bill Fagy that tells this story, and he likens it to a cathedral. And he said, in the Middle Ages, you had the royal families and artisans and others, wealthy people, come together and combined efforts to build these cathedrals. And when they started working on them, they knew they wouldn't see it would take 100 years in the lifespan. There were artisans that were working that knew they would never see the completion of what they were working on, and yet there was no evidence that it affected the quality of their work. And he said, similarly, in public health, we're building cathedrals. We may not see the outcome at the end, but we're working to make something beautiful and lasting. And so for those of you that have chosen that as your career and have provided leadership in the community, I say thank you for your work on building those monuments, and let's continue together.